heat exchanger and throttling device. These are the devices that we are going to consider for first law. These are some typical examples. Okay. So let us begin with the nozzle. So nozzle looks like this. Basically, you let us say you have a pipe where the fluid is flowing, and then you reduce the diameter. Okay, so diameter reduces from this to this. And we'll start with the steady flow energy equation. So we'll assume that this device is under steady operation, and we'll use that. This is the steady flow energy equation that we saw in the last slide. Okay. Now, basically, for all the examples that we'll consider, we'll first start with the steady flow energy equation, and then we'll take simplifying assumptions, or we'll consider what exactly is the scenario there. Okay. So one assumption is we can simply assume that there is no heat transfer and work done. So basically what I'm assuming is that these nozzle valves are insulated. Okay. So no heat is getting transferred, and anyway, there is no moving part here or any device which can extract or supply work. So I can also assume no work is done. Then I'm assuming that there's no change in potential energy. Okay, velocity is changing, so kinetic energy will change, but we can say that they are at the same level from the ground. And another interesting assumption is that depending on the diameter, okay, if your diameter is not very different, then this is not true. But if you have very different diameters, so this one is very small compared to this, then you can assume that V2 is much larger than V1. Okay, in that case, now let us see what we'll do. Let me get a pen. Okay, so assuming no heat transfer means I will cancel this term. No work done means cancel this term. No change in potential energy. Potential energy is this. Okay, now if we consider that V2 is much greater than V1. So this one you have to be a little careful. You have to check what is the diameters involved, and this is an approximation. Then we can say that this energy can be neglected in comparison to this one. Okay, that may or may not be true in most of the conditions, but this is one simplifying assumptions. Based on that, we get H1 is equal to H2 plus kinetic energy of H2. Okay. So this is one simplifying assumptions. Most of the cases you can consider this also. If it is the velocity is significant, you can add this. Otherwise, this is also acceptable. Okay. So if I write this, then I can get the velocity at 2 in terms of delta H. I can shift this to LHS root 2 of 2 multiplied by this root of H1 minus H2. Is this okay to everyone?
Sir, 2 be root, sir.
The calculation is wrong, I guess. 2 will be inside the root, sir.
Ah, yes. Sorry. It is a typo. Let me correct it. Why it is not getting me? Okay, anyway, I will correct it and upload it. Not able to edit it now. Anyway, I will correct and upload it. So you can write this at inside the root. That's correct. It will be here. Okay. Moving on. Similarly, we look at the diffuser. So diffuser is very similar to a nozzle. Only the initial diameter is small and the diameter is increasing. Okay. Similarly, we'll start with the steady flow energy equation. We'll take similar assumptions. So we'll say no heat transfer, Q getting cancelled, no work done, WX getting cancelled, no change in potential energy. So this I will cancel. And again, similarly, we assume that now this one is more. So basically we are dealing with continuity. So this holds true. So when you see that the area of two is much larger, so this velocity will be much higher, right? Now, similarly, this time we'll cancel this V2 and we get H1 plus half square is equal to H2. Similarly, this also will go, this two will go inside. There's a small typo here. Fine. So this was for nozzle and diffuser. Now let us look at some devices where heat transfer and work is also involved. These are the simplest examples that you'll see. Now let us talk about gas turbine engine. So this is how it looks. So this is a cut section of a gas turbine, and I wanted to spend some time on this because there was some doubt in the last class. So basically what you see here is this is the compressor section. Okay, the fluid is getting compressed. We'll look into more detail. And this is the combustor where you burn fuel. And the last section is the turbine section. Okay, so we look at a schematic, how it looks. So in a schematic, you can see this initial part up to here is compression. Then there is a combustor and this region is turbine. Okay. So this is a cut section. In a schematic diagram, we show a gas turbine engine like this. So what we show is that this is the compressor, pressure enters it, then it goes and burns in the combustion chamber, then it comes to turbine and then it gets exhausted. Okay, so basically what happens is that we are compressing air in the compressor. So compressor is doing work. And when the air moves out, it actually rotates the turbine and it does work on the turbine. Okay, so let me take one analogous example. So you all must have seen a table fan and a windmill. So can anyone tell what is the difference between them? What is the major difference apart from size?
One converts electrical energy into mechanical, one and other mechanical energy into electrical.
Yes. So basically the left one, fan. Fan, it takes electricity and it moves, it rotates, and because of its rotation, it makes the air flow through it. Okay. It forces the air to move. While on the other hand, air moves and air rotates the blades. Okay, so the major difference is this blade is doing work on the air. So this is negative work. Okay, generally we consider air as our system. Then the fan blade is working on the air. It means that the work is negative. Now here what happens? Here air is doing work on this blade. Moving air will make the blade rotate. So then we call this is positive work because air is doing work on the surrounding. Let us say this is the surrounding and air is our system. Is this clear to everyone? What is negative and what is positive work?
Yes, sir.
Fine. So similar example we'll see in gas turbine and combustor. So, okay, whatever I mentioned just now. So moving blade imparts velocity to air, and this can be classified as negative work. Similarly, moving air make the wind turbine blade rotate. So this is classified as positive work. Now let us go to gas turbine engines. So what happens here is, you see the initial part, compression section. So this is how a compressor looks like. So this is working like a fan. It rotates and it sucks air. Okay, it is forcing the air to move inside. There we say that this is having negative work. Okay, gas gets compressed, pressure, density and specific volume, pressure and density increase and specific volume decreases. This is the reverse of density. Moving blades flows the fluid to move. As we have seen in the last slide, that's why it is negative work. Now coming to turbine. So what happens is that you force air inside, the air gets burnt here, and then that air with high energy that is trying to move out. Now the turbine obstructs. Okay. So air has to rotate the turbine to go out. It is designed in such a way. So in turbine, gas is expanding. So pressure may remain constant, but density will decrease. Pressure density decreases, specific volume increases, and what we are seeing in the last slide, moving fluid makes the blade rotate. So this is a case of positive work. Okay, I hope this is clear to everyone. What is negative and what is positive?
The pressure will remain constant.
Your voice is breaking.
Sir, pressure will remain constant.
Can you repeat the question?
Sir, pressure will remain constant or it will decrease?
Pressure will decrease. Pressure will decrease. So pressure will increase here. Okay, for compressor, pressure is increasing. So here you start with atmospheric pressure, then the pressure will increase up to here. Then after that, it will decrease. Let us say pressure increases like this in the compressor and then it decreases in the turbine. Okay. Anyway, you will study about gas turbine in more detail in later chapters. So we have a chapter on gas power cycles where we'll talk about more detail on what are the actual operations. So it basically works on Brayton cycle. Brayton cycle we'll discuss. Okay. Then it will be, I hope, more clear. Just now, I just wanted you to be clear with positive and negative work, and this is negative and this is positive. That's all. Okay. Can you move on? Fine. Moving on to next slide. So we'll talk about what is the energy conservation in compressor and turbine, assuming steady flow. So we start with the steady flow energy equation. We assume no changes in kinetic and potential energies. Okay. We can also assume that there is no heat transfer. So we can remove Q and we can say what is remaining. H1 is equal to H2 plus Wx. Okay. So we can say the work is difference of enthalpy, delta H. Okay, now you see the difference in turbine and compressor. So for compressor, H1 is less than H2, so work is negative. Similarly for turbine, now turbine, this is 1. Okay, so this enthalpy is more than what enthalpy is leaving. So definitely some work has been done there and work is positive. Okay, this is clear to everyone.
Sir,
any questions on this?
Sir, yes. Sir, for the compressor, yes, sir. Sir, जो compressor है उसके लिए जब air बाहर थी तब तो सर उसकी velocity बहुत कम होगी, लेकिन जैसे ही वो compress होकर अंदर आएगी तो सर speed नहीं बढ़ेगी उसकी वजह से?
हाँ, okay. So this is also in okay. So this generally we have this gas turbine system in an aircraft. Okay, aircraft is moving with some velocity. So, relatively, yes, you will have some velocity of air that this is coming in.
Okay, sir.
So, if you, it is not that air is at zero velocity. Air is, because this whole thing is moving forward. So, relatively, air is coming towards it. Okay. But if you want to be more accurate, then you can take both the velocities. See, let me.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So, let me do it again. So in general, I will tell you, see, in general, this is a very valid assumption that potential energy generally does not change. Okay. Heat transfer also, if you have insulated it or if it is an adiabatic process that we'll study, then heat transfer, you can neglect simply. But this is something which you need to double check. So generally, we assume if there is a large change, for example, in nozzle, then we considered one velocity to be negligible and one to be more. Whereas for compressor or turbine, we generally consider this to be not very different. Okay. So because of that, we cancel both the terms. But if you want to do more accurate calculations, that we'll see. Once you look at the numericals, you'll see if suppose there's a large difference in V1 and V2, then you need to consider. But in general, you'll see that this is good enough when you need some approximate value. Okay, so this is the basic equation for all your first law applications, but we'll modify it for different examples. So this is one of the modifications. If an example you have velocity which is significant, then we'll consider that. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Moving on, now let us talk about heat exchanger. So have you seen a car radiator? In front of a car, you have something like this. So what it does? Can anyone explain?
Cools the engine, sir.
Sir, cools the fluid. Sir, cools the fluid of the
engine, sir.
Cools the inlet of the engine. No, it is not cooling the engine inlet. It is actually cooling engine oil, or what is circulating inside the engine. So basically, let us take, let us say some fluid it cools. How it cools? What is the cooling fluid here?
Sir, air.
Correct. So air is coming from the front. Air moves past this. There are fins or blades, and air is cooling the liquid. Okay, let us say there's some liquid inside the engine, which is getting cooled by the air. So this is a very simple example for heat exchanger. So there are various types of heat exchanger: parallel flow, counter flow, cross flow. We'll start with a simple example. This is parallel flow. So basically, we see there are two fluids, fluid A and fluid B. Okay, let us say this is hot. Fluid A is hot, and this is fluid B is cooling that. So as you can see, both of the fluids are moving in positive x direction. Okay, so this one and this one both are moving in this direction. So let us put numbers to the entries. So we'll say fluid A inlet is 1, fluid B inlet is 2, and fluid A exit is 3, and fluid B exit is 4. So let us begin with that. Let us see how do we apply energy balance or a steady flow energy equation for a heat exchanger like this. So now we have taken the full equation. Okay, so we'll simplify step by step. This is our energy conservation equation, and basically, we need to sum over all the inlets and exits. Here we have two inlets and two exits. Okay, let us see how we go about it. So when we talk about steady state, we'll say, okay, this is zero. So we'll simplify it in this form. Now, let us take some simplifying assumptions, okay, which are mostly true. So generally, for such a system, there is no work done. So I can simply strike this off. Then no heat transfer between surroundings. So this is a very interesting assumption. So we are assuming that whatever heat transfer takes place, that takes place between these two fluids, okay? Between fluid A and B, and not with surrounding. So with that, I remove this. And again, we can say that potential energy is generally true. It is very accurate to remove these two. This also, for this particular condition, the change in kinetic energy will not be enough. So we can remove this also. So now we are left with mass and enthalpy. So the energy balance equation reduces to conservation of mass into enthalpy. So this is what we have to do. Okay. Now, this particular equation we'll try to apply in the system. Okay, now we'll write in terms of A and B. So at the inlet, what I can say, what is the sum of inlet enthalpy and mass? M dot A for this stream and M dot B for this stream. So M dot A, let us say this is at station 1, so H1. M dot B, because it is at 2, so I'll say H2. Fine. Similarly, let us look at the exit. So at the exit, what we have? Fluid A is leaving at 3. So M dot A into H3 plus M dot B at H4. Fine. So can I write the sum of this is equal to sum of this? What is written on the top? So I can say sum of this quantity comes here on the LHS, and this quantity comes in the RHS. This is the energy balance for a heat exchanger. Is this okay to everyone? Any questions? Okay, so I think everyone is clear. So basically, for any numerical, yes.
In this,
any question?
Yes, sir. these both liquid are directly mixed or yes, they are separated by something?
Yes, so let us say there is a wall. Okay. So they are just getting cooled. They are not mixing. So let me get some other color. So you see there is a wall between them. These two liquids are not getting mixed. The two are separated. But because of the wall, so basically these are two tubes. Okay, one big tube, one small tube. So fluid is going, A is going inside this small tube. And let me write it down. So A is going inside the small tube, B is going on the surrounding tube. So the fluids are not mixing, but they are transferring heat. Okay, is it clear now?
Yes, sir.
Fine. So finally, we derive this equation for mass balance. Energy conservation of energy. So you will get numericals where you have, let us say, 4 enthalpies are required. You have 1 is missing. H3 is missing. You have H1, H4, H2. You need to calculate H3, or you need to calculate what is the temperature there. So we'll see when we go to numericals. So most of these applications, it will be much more clear once you try these numericals and when you look at the numerical values. Okay, now let us take another example, which is called throttling device. Okay, so this is a device, sir? Where, yes, please continue.
Sir, in that previous question, sir, previous one.
Yes. Yes.
Sir, here cooling fluid can also be water, or it must be air only?
It could be any fluid. It could be water, sir. It could be oil. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Sir?
I'm not mentioned what is the nature of that fluid. It could be gas, it could be liquid, it could be any liquid. We are just taking a general notation, fluid A and fluid B. We'll see based on whatever heat exchanger we have, what type of fluid this is. Okay. Yes. There was another question.
Sir, when we are, for exit and for the inlet, we have taken MA dot to be same in both of them. So, sir, does we have to apply the equation of continuity to find MA dot and they are same or different?
Okay, so if the fluids are not mixing, okay, so that is one assumption. Anyway, if they mix also, MA dot will not change. Okay, so this is a, there's a separate pipe. We are entering, MA dot is entering. So from the right, MA dot will go out.
Okay.
Mass sir. Balance.
Okay, sir.
Okay, so for example, let us say 5 kilogram of liquid is entering per second, 5 kilograms of water. So from the right side, 5 kilograms will go out, right? If assuming there is no other leakage or no other inlet here, there's only one inlet and one outlet. So that will hold true. Mass will be conserved.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Okay. Now moving on to throttling device. So in throttling, what we do is we have a constricted passage. Okay. So we block the passage partially, and because of that there is a huge pressure drop. Okay, pressure decreases while passing the fluid through constricted passage, and this is again a part of refrigeration system. So when we go to that chapter, then we'll study this in more detail. Okay, right now you just need to know what is throttling, but what are the design aspects, where it is used, what is the cycle that is used, that we'll study in refrigeration systems. Okay, so the example of throttle is partially opened valve, which you see here, porous plug or capillary tubes. So these are some examples of throttle devices. Okay, now first law is also valid for any such device. So we'll try to apply the steady flow energy equation here. So we'll start with that. Now we'll take, So we'll say that there's no heat transfer. Heat transfer means Q term will be knocked off, no work done, Wx is zero, assuming negligible change in potential and kinetic energy. So we'll cut these terms. Okay, so what we're left with? H1 is equal to H2. So for any throttling device, any numerical you get where throttling device is given, you can simply say that H1 will be equal to H2. Enthalpy is constant in throttling. So this is one of the principles in refrigeration that we'll study in more detail in later chapters. Okay. Moving on, now let us talk about transitivity. So all the examples that we have talked till now that have involved steady processes. Now let us talk about unsteady processes. Okay.
Sir, how velocity remains constant in that
this is the
throttling device?
See, if you look at the cross section, this cross section is same as this.
Sir, but pressure is changing.
Okay. Pressure is changing, but actually what will happen is fluid phase will also change. So liquid will evaporate. So a lot of things are involved. Okay, so that's why I told, let us wait for this chapter. Then you will study. So there is phase change is involved here. Okay, so I will request you to wait for this chapter. It will move much more clear. We have not covered the phase equilibrium and topics, related topics. So then it will be, I need those background to discuss this in more detail. That background you don't have so far. So wait for that and then we'll talk about this. We'll talk about this in much more detail. Okay. Are you clear?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So moving on, let us go to unsteady processes. Okay, so for unsteady, we'll use this equation which we derived initially. This is for energy balance and dt is involved. So now this will use for unsteady. Now let us take one simple example. Let us say that this is my control volume, which is shown in dotted line. This is, let us say, any box on a system where fluid is entering from the left, fluid is leaving from the right. Okay, so this general principle applies to multiple inlets or multiple exits. But to keep our life simple, I'll assume that there's only one inlet and one exit. Let us start with that. And we say that some heat is getting transferred. It will be Q dot CV and W dot X. System is doing some work and system is receiving some heat. Okay. Now, what is the energy, total energy of the fluid that is entering the control volume? So that will be MI into what the rate of fluid into enthalpy plus kinetic plus potential energy. Similarly, for the fluid that is leaving the control volume, I will say that M dot E is the mass, that is rate of fluid leaving it. Then again, we take sum of all the energy components, enthalpy, kinetic energy, and potential energy. Okay. Now, what is the energy contained? So let us say at this particular time, ECV is the total energy which is inside this control volume. Okay. So that ECV I can write as MCV, what is the mass inside the control volume, into U plus kinetic energy plus potential energy. Now I have one interesting question. So here I am saying U, but for moving fluid I have said HE. Why is that so? For fluid exiting, I am talking about enthalpy. While fluid inside it, I am talking about U, not H.
Because it is controlled volume system.
So what?
Sir, H is equal to U plus PV and in control volume, so sir, PV will be equal to zero, I guess.
Yes, so because
so H is equal to U.
Yes, so I assume that inside it is stationary. So this is that PV term is not it is negligible here. So for control volume, I say U, but when the fluid is moving, it has some velocity, then it is doing some work, flow work basically. So there I need PV and it becomes H. Okay, this is clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay, moving on. So this is the equation we have. Now let us apply it for control volume. So let us expand these terms. So we'll add, expand ECV and write it in these terms. RHS is same. Okay. Now, what is changing? So this is for, this is the rate equation. Okay. D by dt. Now let us say for some time delta t, I want to find what has changed. What is the change of energy in some right amount of time? So that energy I can say delta ECV. Now this will be equal to difference in whatever the total amount of heat supplied minus work done, plus I will integrate these equations. Okay, with respect to dt. So I will integrate it for time t. So now here m dot is dm by dt, that is what I am assuming. So this will get cancelled. So it will be dm. Okay, so if you look at this integrations, I have written as dm by dt. So dt dt gets cancelled and we left with dm. Dmi dme. This is the mass which is entering per unit time, per unit dt. Is this clear? There's some background noise. If someone has not muted, please mute yourself. Okay, so the last equation. Everyone is clear how we got to this point?
Yes, sir.
Fine. Moving on. Now let us take an example. Let us say that I want to apply first law for filling gas or any fluid in a tank. Okay, so let's say at time t is equal to zero. So let us say, okay, what is happening here is that there's a pipe. Okay, fluid is flowing in a pipe. Any fluid with, and we assume the enthalpy of the fluid is HP and VP is the velocity. So fluid with some properties is moving in a pipe. Now I connect that pipe to a tank. This is the tank which initially has M1 mass of fluid and U1 is the internal energy. That is the initial conditions and it is connected by a valve. So I open this valve and fluid starts entering. So at time t equal to t, we have the mass inside this as M2 and mass internal energy is U2. Okay, so this change has happened over time t. There is the... Okay, so for time t, we have filled the tank from some initial condition to final condition. And the pipe conditions remain same. Pipe is anyway going at the same conditions. Okay, now if we apply energy conservation, what we have discussed in the last slide, if I want to take delta E CV, okay, what is my CV? Can anyone tell me? What is the control volume?
Tank, sir.
Tank. So volume of tank is control volume. So again, I apply the same equation that we have derived in the last slide. So we see that this is what we have. Okay, now we look into different terms. So what are the assumptions involved? No work is done. Okay. Also, there is no exit from the tank. Fluid is just entering the tank, but it is not leaving. So we can simply cancel this term, right? Now the last part, we'll assume that there is no change in potential energy. Generally, when we talk about Z, gaseous fluid, so this is not important. So we'll assume this is negligible and we're left with this term only. So we'll consider some heat transfer, and finally we have this equation. Okay. Now, this is what we have in the last slide. So we know that hi is the enthalpy of the fluid that is entering, which can be said to be same as what is there in the pipe, so which remains constant. Okay, so this quantity I am taking out of the integration, and inside the integration we have dm only. This is constant. Okay, I can take it out. So if I integrate it, I will be having this equation. Okay, delta I CV is QCV plus whatever the energy content into delta M. This is, can you tell me what is this M2 minus M1?
So the amount of mass entered in the tank.
Yes. So this is the initial mass, this is the final mass. So M2 minus M1 is the mass that has entered in that given time. Whatever is the total fluid that is entering for time t. Okay, so this is my energy balance. Now let us look at what delta E is. Delta E is basically M2 U2 minus M1 E1 U1. Okay. Now if I substitute this, this is my equation for energy balance for filling of a tank. Okay. Any questions over this?
Sir, can you please explain the second line?
Which line? This one?
Yes, sir.
So from the last slide, we have got this equation. This is okay?
Yes, sir.
Let me remove it and explain to it again. So what I am saying is, in this equation, this you are okay with, right? Now what is HI? Let me go back to the last slide. So what is HI? HI is the enthalpy of fluid that is entering the control volume, right? That will be equal to enthalpy at the pipe. This is only, this fluid is only coming, right?
Yes.
And similarly for VP, VI, VP. You agree to that?
Okay, sir.
Okay. So, okay, sir. In this slide, I say that this is HP and this is VP. Now, this is constant. Okay. So when I'm doing integration, I take this bracket becomes constant. So this constant, I take it outside of integration. Okay. So inside I'm left with dm. Fine. Now yes. If I integrate dm, I will get delta m, whatever is entering. So this is clear?
Sir, here yes. It should be m2 e2 minus m1 e1.
M2
E2 and E2 is equals to U2 plus half VP square.
That's what inside will not consider H if it is a close. Okay. So this we assume that the fluid is stationary inside the tank. So if it is a stationary fluid, then we'll account for only U. If it is moving, then I'll talk about H.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Okay. So moving on, let us now talk about evacuated tank. What we have discussed is that tank.
Yes. U here.
U is the internal energy.
Okay.
Okay. So for a moving fluid, we talk in terms of H. For a stationary fluid, we talk in terms of U.
Okay.
Fine. Now, let us say that M1 is 0. So, so let us say M1 is 0, VP is also equal to 0. So, it is a high pressure tank, velocity is not significant, and no heat transfer. That is one special case, initially evacuated tank. So for that, if you apply this equation, what will happen? M1 is 0, so this will be 0, Q is 0, HP will be remaining, and VP also, let us say, is 0, M1 is 0 again. So we are left with M2 U2 is equal to M2 HP, HP M2. Is this clear to everyone? What we have done here? We are talking about initially evacuated tank. So initially there is nothing inside. The tank is having zero mass and fluid is coming from this pipe only. Initially this M is equal to zero. This is our M1, this is zero. And I open the valve and fluid starts coming from this pipe. This is what we are discussing. And we have further assumed that the velocity here is negligible. It is basically, let us say, a high pressure tank or high pressure pipe. Okay, so if we start with that, we can cancel off some terms and we are left with this. Is this okay to everyone? The last equation what we have?
Yes, sir.
Fine. Now, M2 will be cancelled, so we are left with U2 is equal to HP. Okay, this will get cancelled. U2 is equal to HP. Now U can be written as CV into T, whatever T is there in a tank. And HP is CP into TP, TP of pipe. Okay, so we can say T2 is equal to gamma TP. T2 of the tank is equal to gamma times TP of the pipe. This is one important result for initially evacuated tank. Okay, is this clear to everyone how we have derived this? Any questions on this these steps? Okay, I hope everyone is clear for this. So this is for filling an initially empty tank, initially evacuated tank. Now let us go back to the reverse process. Let us say I have a tank which is filled. I want to evacuate that tank. Okay, so we'll apply the same equation there. Now this time, this will get cancelled. There's no fluid that is entering the system, but the fluid is leaving the system. And again, we'll cancel potential energy. So we'll have this equation. Similarly, we can substitute delta E here and we can derive this. Okay. So this is the equation for emptying a tank. Any questions so far?
Sir, here VE is also zero.
Yes, we'll see, that's what we'll take some simplifying assumptions. We'll assume that whatever is exiting has minimal or almost zero velocity.
Okay, sir.
Fine. Okay.
Sir?
Yes.
Sir, in the slide number 56, I have a doubt.
56. Okay, let me go back. Yes, 56.
Sir, in this, how you write HI equal to HP?
Okay, so what is HI?
HI, the initial enthalpy which is coming with the air which is flowing.
Air or fluid. Okay, so what is flowing inside? So this is the inlet here, right? Let me get a pen. This is the inlet. What is coming in, you tell me. Fluid is coming in, right? I think I have to take all the fluid which is coming in, right?
Hmm.
Fluid is coming in as HP. Fluid is coming from pipe. Okay?
Hmm.
So that is what we are doing here. HI, because whatever inlet is there, at the inlet, we have HP. So that's why I have written HI as HP.
So sir, can HP be written as UP as the fluid is not flowing inside the tank, but it is flowing inside the pipe only. It is stopping when it goes in the tank. So
yes.
Flow work will be zero.
It has to spend some work to enter this tank. Lower cannot be zero.
Okay.
See, if some amount of fluid is there in the tank, so some pressure will be there. It has to oppose that pressure and enter it.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why whenever it is flowing, I will say HP. When it is inside a tank, I will say U. U. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Fine. So with that, we finish this chapter on first law. These are the reference books, and we'll stop for today. Now we'll let me stop this recording. We'll talk about